Hi, my name's John. A year ago, I never even heard of Fruits Basket. That is until my girlfriend introduced the anime to me.
And I'm Allie. I've been reading the manga since I was in third grade.
We loved watching season one together so much, and we'd have all these crazy long discussions about what happened in each episode.
And for season two, we thought it would be really fun to share our conversations with you.
So join us today as we talk about season two, episode 11, All Mine. So before we get started, if you're a returning listener, then welcome back. And if you're a new listener, we're glad to have you on our Fruits Basket podcast. And if you want to stay up to date with all of our Fruits Basket content, then make sure to go down and subscribe and hit the notification bell so you never miss an episode. But with all that out of the way, where are we starting?
Well, first of all, I know how you feel about this episode. But I need everyone else to know how you feel about this episode, so go off.
My god, this was literally the best episode of Fruits Basket, like, literally ever. I'm so pumped about this episode, because it had everything. It had the little Fruits Basket funny moments, it had plot, it made me cry. It had everything. Oh my. Okay. Yeah.
I will say that the Kagura confession chapter is one of my favorite chapters. It is in my top 10. I know I'm always out here saying, like, this is such a big moment. I love this moment in the manga. But, like, for real, guys, no jokes. This is in my top 10 manga moments. Like, top 10 manga chapters. Kagura's confession. So I was very, very, very excited for this to happen. I have kind of slyly built it up in John's mind. I've, like, let you know that something big was gonna happen for me, so I'm happy we got here.
Yeah, but you didn't really say what. And when I saw Kagura in the preview images, I was like, oh god, okay, here we go. But it was so good.
She served us. Oh my gosh, I loved this.
The episode starts out with Kagura on the floor as her mom's just vacuuming, and I was like, that's a big mood, because that's how I was by the end of the episode.
Oh yeah, just like on the floor, not moving. But yeah, so we start out that way, and there's no opening. Suspicious, they leave it for the end. Which, you know, you just feel it building. Like, when's this going to happen? When's the opening going to happen? And when they started playing the music at the end, I cried.
Yeah. But we kind of... Do you have anything left that you want to talk about with that?
No, not really, no.
Okay. So then we actually get to go to the house. And the fact that IMA was literally just a squatter.
Oh my gosh. And he was only squatting for a day and made that much mess.
Oh, it made me so happy. And the fact that he was feeling bad for not being able to help Yuki through the Akito thing again, I don't know. I thought that was... I really like Ayame. Like, I really do. Even though this sentimentality is short-lived, as it always is with him, I thought that was just, like, a really nice brotherly moment before he was weird again.
Yeah, before he was IMA again.
Well, yeah.
But yeah, I did really appreciate that line where he said, I was unable to help you again. Because it hurts. It hits you deep. But he can never stay serious for too long.
Which is totally a defense mechanism.
You think so?
Like, I think so. I think that when he starts getting too deep or too past the surface level, I think he starts freaking out. And that's why he has to, like, really quickly whiplash back to the very eccentric IMA-ness that we all know and some of us love. I love it. So I think it's totally a defense mechanism so that even though he wants to help Yuki, I feel like he doesn't want anyone to see too far into him, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay. I think he's keeping his guard up.
Maybe. But, so they're figuring out all of their IMA troubles, and our girl Toru's calling Kazuma, which at the time we didn't know it was him, but, you know, we figured that out.
Yeah.
And Listen, everyone. I know some things got cut in this little manga readers. I know. And it was in, like, a little bit in the Kazuma phone call scene, a little bit after that, and a little bit with when Tohru meets with Kazuma. I know things got cut. I have full faith that the scene that all manga readers are thinking of will come back in the future. Don't worry about it. It'll work out. I have full faith. I have full faith. So that's my little two cents, because I know that that's on every manga reader's mind right now, is what got cut. Because this was like 2.25 chapters in one episode. So if the pacing felt weird, which I didn't think the pacing was bad. Did you think the pacing was bad?
I thought that the pacing was perfect. If you had told me that absolutely nothing was cut and they adapted it word for word from the books, I would have fully believed you.
Yeah, well, yeah, okay. There you go. There's an anime-only opinion. But like, I didn't think the
pacing
was bad.
I thought everything about this episode was perfect.
I cried a lot. I really enjoyed it. So that's my two cents as a manga reader.
So let's just cut straight to Kazuma. And so I thought that this was so nice. Like, this whole, like, obviously she's going to him to talk about the curse. And maybe I'm just really just hyped up about this episode. I think that that's, everything's just really nice about this episode. I don't know, I'm hyped. But I thought that this was really a cool scene, because I feel like these are the two characters that we know of right now that are really close to the Zodiac, that both want to essentially break the curse, or at least help Kyo and the rest of the Somas not have to have this awful, very Akito-centric fate.
Mm-hmm.
And so, now that it's almost the meeting of the minds, in a way, I felt like this was actually a really, really big moment.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly it, yeah.
Because Kazuma, talking about his grandpa's grave very far away, and how his grandpa can't be buried with the rest of the Somas, I thought that just really hammered home just how sad it all was. And then he even dovetailed it with saying that, but at least now he's outside.
Yeah, that part hurts. That even when you die, like, you're still being held to the standards of the curse.
Yeah.
It hurts. Ugh.
But best dad and best girl breaking the curse together.
Heck yeah.
But what really, really interested in me, which we kind of alluded to this in the last episode, but Kazuma describes Akito like a small, unstable child, which I thought was funny because I said something similar in the last podcast about him just being at the developmental age of a child. But something really, really interesting about Akito when he's saying that is it was like a frame. It was very short. It was very quick. But it was just Akito's face, and he was looking really, really sad.
Hmm.
Which, when I think about Akito, I don't think sad. I think evil. I think sadistic. I think scary, as referenced again by the last episode. But when I saw that he was sad, I feel like this curse has an adverse effect on him, even though he's quote-unquote God, just as much of an adverse effect on him as everyone else. Because if he's in this childlike mentality, what happens when a child gets sad or upset? They throw a tantrum, they lash out. We know that Akito's constantly sick, pretty much, right?
Yeah, just about.
And so I feel like the curse is doing something to Akito to make him so sad and upset all the time. And while I don't think it's right or good in any way, I feel like trying to control everything around him is the only way that he can kind of feel that autonomy or feel that belonging that he wants, if that makes kind of sense.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe.
So, I don't know. I think that there's a lot more to Akito than just evil god man. I think I actually want him, I feel like this might be a controversial statement, but I actually want him to be redeemed by the end of the show. I feel like he is suffering just as much as everyone else, and even though he's the antagonist, I'm sure there will be a lot of reasons for us to loathe him down the line. I kind of want to see him get redeemed, or like helped by the curse being broken as well, you know?
Yeah. Akito redemption? Ooh.
Yeah.
You're saying wild things right now, John.
I don't know. I think that that would be really interesting, showing that even the worst of the worst can be redeemed and helped. Because obviously Akito hates being looked down on or helped, but if he was able to, then that would be really interesting.
Ooh, I like the way you think. Okay. Alrighty. So, another big moment that happened, symbolism time with Allie. John had noticed that a bird flew right over to, like, the little pond outside of Kazuma and Toru's little place where they're sitting and talking in the dojo. And so while they're chatting specifically about Kyo being confined, this bird appears. And I just immediately wrote it off as, like, bird symbolism. Like, oh, okay, yeah, it's talking about freedom and, you know, being a caged bird, and this bird's free so it can fly away into the sky, and that's, you know, what's going on. But John says to me, wow, I wonder what kind of bird that is. I wonder if that's symbolic. And I do flowers. I don't do birds. So I was like, I don't know what kind of bird that is, but I looked it up. And that bird is a wagtail, specifically a black-backed wagtail or a Japanese pied wagtail. So in Japanese folklore, these birds are viewed as a bird of passion and desire. They were heavily involved in the creation story that the Japanese indigenous people had believed in, and they acted as a type of, like, Cupid character, where they would pair couples up and, like, teach them how to make love. So it's kind of like a passion desire kind of bird. So it could mean freedom, it could mean
saucy.
This passion, which is interesting that they're showing this specific type of bird while Tohru is talking about Kyo being confined forever. So
even the bird ships it.
The bird ships Kyoru.
Yeah. Yeah.
That could mean what it symbolizes, if you want to believe that. So, yeah, the bird ships Kyoru. Okay.
No, yeah. Bird 100% ships Kyoru. But then they kind of are talking about the curse and everything, and how the Zodiac have a bond of blood with each other, and the bond is the curse. Like, that intrinsic bond is what keeps them in this awful situation. And Toru's response to that was so just sad.
What, when she thinks bonds are supposed to be precious things and thinks of her mom? Mm-hmm.
Yes. It's almost like dueling ideologies, kinda. The Somas see bonds as something that keeps them tied down and confined, whereas Tohru sees bonds as being something precious. And so I think that the bonds that they form with her and, like, Kazuma and Kureno and Uotani, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, I think that's what will break these more intrinsic bonds that they're born with. The bonds that they develop will overcome the bonds that they're born with, or something like that.
Okay.
So that they have more... Once they have more autonomy and ownership, they even say that it's hard for them to openly defy Akito, meaning that there's some voodoo magic in there, kinda.
Okay. Maybe. So, you said Tohru thinks of bonds as being precious, which is what she says.
Yes.
And I'm gonna play devil's advocate for a little bit, and I'm just gonna try and bring up something that's a little controversial. So, in the beach arc, Tohru talks about how she's, like, dealing with her mother. And she is sitting on that balcony and she's whispering it's okay to herself when she's thinking about her mom passing away. So, are bonds always precious, even when they have to be forcefully broken.
When you say forcefully broken.
Like, her mom passed away, so that bond had to be broken immediately.
Did it, though? Because I don't think that just because someone dies that the bond is broken, you know? Because
not entirely, that but bond, then it's not reciprocal.
Does it need to be? I mean, like, that sounds weird, but, like, that bond between Tohru and her mother, while she's still having a lot of time and still going through that grieving process and still has those really awful feelings, which is normal. She's still within that normal duration of time that she would be grieving, like, a lost loved one. But that bond is so important to her and has helped to shape her so profoundly that I think that saying that, even though, yes, it was forcibly quote-unquote broken, I think that that's still a really important bond to her and is still something that will forever be super precious to her. So, and since we know that Kyo has a bond with Kyoko, to, it seems like, a meaningful degree, I feel like that bond is precious to him too, even though she died. And so I guess what I'm trying to say is, I don't think that just because someone's gone, the bond has to necessarily be broken. And that bond can still lead to strength elsewhere.
Okay. I just wanted to get your take on that.
So I wouldn't call that broken. And I think that sometimes bonds do need to be broken. There are always going to be toxic people in your life. And sometimes it's important to cut off the dead meat, I guess.
It's interesting that you bring up bonds being broken, because it looks like Isuzu is trying to do quite literally the same thing.
Yes. Yeah. She's trying to break the bonds too, but she's trying to do it internally. I don't think that's gonna fly.
You don't think so?
I think Shigure is trying to do the exact same thing, but he knows that it won't fly, and that's why he's getting Tohru involved so profoundly. And I think that's why Isuzu went to Shigure, is because she knows that he's doing this and she wants to help, you know? She wants in on it.
Maybe.
And maybe she does. I think that he kept his lips sealed about his plans for Tohru because, I don't know, Isuzu's a kid. She might ruin it. And if he's looking for love, like we've kind of theorized, and that's his big be-all end-all, I don't think he'd want to risk that on a hot-tempered Rin, you know?
Yeah, good theorizing.
I feel like it's all a big chess game for Shigure right now.
And he's like a chess master? Moving all the pieces where they gotta go?
Yeah, I think sometimes he'll have to, just like in chess, he'll have to sacrifice pieces that will ultimately be for the greater good. He's kind of indicated that he's not afraid of letting someone get hurt if it means succeeding in his goals. And so, yeah, I think this is a big game of chess for his end-all be-all.
Okay. So did you have anything else on that whole Tohru visiting Kazuma a little bit?
The last thing I really had was when he says, "When you smile, the world feels gentler."
Yeah.
I thought that was really cute, but that's unintentionally putting a lot on that girl who already has issues with putting on a happy facade. So now it almost reinforces that she needs to put on that facade for them all the time. And that's just not healthy for her, because now she'll still be just having that full range of emotions only in private, potentially. And she'll feel like it's her job again to be the rock in the happiness, even though bottling everything up will be, in the long run, bad for her.
That's so interesting to call out. Oh, so, I'm sad. Okay.
Yeah. So, I thought it was... He meant well, but I feel like that could have an adverse effect on her.
Yeah. Okay. So, we get a little Kagura and Kyo scene as well. Mm-hmm. And this scene, I cry every single time I read it. I've cried both times that we've watched the episode, because when Kyo gets called out for not going to the dojo as often, because Kazuma wants him to treasure his time in the house, aka like with Tohru, it kills me. It kills me every time. I cry every time.
Yeah, you got emotional at that part.
Yeah, both times I'm like, I can't do it. I can't do this scene. I can't. It's so good.
That was a really good scene. But so they decide they're going on a date. But then after that, we go back to the Soma house, and this whole scene is just hilariously perfect to me in every single way.
What with Tohru and Yuki and then Kyo coming in? Tell me about it.
Okay, I'll tell you all about it.
Please.
Because it just hits on all of their characters so perfectly, like, to where they've developed up to this point. Because Tohru, she just kind of talks. She's a little bit oblivious, and she's kind of an open book in terms of a lot of things. Not really for her emotions, but whatever. And she, not even, like, 5 minutes after she gets back and they're, like, washing dishes or whatever they're doing, she's like, oh yeah, I saw Rin. And just like almost lets it slip that she went to see Shisho.
Mm-hmm.
And when Yuki is like, what? Why? She's like, crap. I don't know. In the middle of town. I don't know. Which like he should have realized that something was up when she started like panicking, but like whatever. She's got them all wrapped.
They're whipped.
Yeah, I mean, honestly. But, and then when Kyo came in and said that he was leaving and Shigure calls out for being a date, and he grabs Toru's ears so she can't hear the word date. I don't know. It was all frantic and really funny. And just, this is what made me like this show so much. And the best part of this is that it is essentially confirmed that Yuki ships Kyo and Tohru.
Yuki is the biggest Kyoru shipper. His face where he's like, you don't walk her home and you don't see, like, you could go do that.
Yeah. And when Kyo says, that's your job, just the look of pure disgust and disdain, like, you idiot. What? I'm literally giving you an opportunity right here. And so this is two episodes in a row where he's, like, poking fun at Kyo for liking Tohru. Because last episode he was, like, with that sly little look on his face, would you like to take my seat? As he's, like, gesturing at Tohru.
Like, do I have to spell it out for you? Please flirt. Like, thank you.
Please flirt. Stop being so dense. And I'm just like, yes, Yuki. Yes. But yeah, also, I don't think Yuki has a crush on Tohru.
I love how you slid that in at the end, just like, yeah, so due to those reasons, I don't believe Yuki has a crush on Tohru.
That is my thesis. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk.
Perfect. Yeah, it is yet to be confirmed, but
okay.
Good theorizing.
Whether it's headcanon or not, it's confirmed for me.
Okay. We'll play along with it then. Yeah, I love that scene too. But then we get our date time with Kyo and Kagura. Which, you know, just take me on a roller coaster of emotions, why don't you?
It was a lot.
It just made me cry.
But Kyo's looking fly for this date.
Oh my gosh, black shirt Kyo, we have been fed. My crops are watered. My taxes are paid. I'm so happy. Black shirt Kyo. Beautiful. Love it.
Your crops would be watered if it was Yuki.
Amen.
Because he's a gardening boy.
I am so mad at you.
Okay. Ew, I did my gross laugh. Okay. I like how Kagura points out just how much Kyo has softened.
Yeah. Has Kyo matured? Or, like, what do you think's going on there?
He's matured, he's more emotionally intelligent, just in general. And I don't think he's as angry at the world right now. I think that his anger before was just him taking everything that he's just holding in out on everyone else. And so now that I think he's less angry and he's more just accepted his situation, I think that's really mellowed him. Because now it's a waste of time for him to be so angry at the world all the time when he has so little time in his mind left.
That's so depressing.
Yeah, I know.
It hurts.
But then we see they kind of go out on their date and they start having the flashbacks. And this absolute goon is just drawing eggs in the sand, fried eggs.
I know, and it makes me cry.
It's like so sad, but so cute.
It's really cute. It's precious. Like, give this boy some fried eggs. But, like, then Kagura in the flashback, in the one flashback, she's like, do you watch any TV shows? What do you like? And he's just drawing fried eggs because he doesn't have anything. And, like, this brings it back to previous episodes where I had mentioned that Kyo always asks if things are fun. And he's like, are these fireworks fun? Are pancakes good? I've never had them. Like, what's fun? I don't know. And this just so profoundly shows that when he was in, I mean, you're the counseling boy. I don't know nothing about early childhood development, but I feel like between the ages of like being born and being 6 years old, having those moments of learning what's fun and bonding with your parents and having like a good time to learn how to be like a future person, a future full functioning person is very important. And it doesn't look like he had that.
So, no, it sounds like his parents were very authoritarian. So like that's one of the four core parenting styles. And essentially, meaning exactly what it sounds like, they had their thumb on absolutely everything he was doing. And that kid really, to an extent, I'm not a parent, I don't want to speak like I am, but that, from a child development perspective, that has the potential to really screw a kid up in later life, because they don't get to explore their individuality and their autonomy. And if a child isn't able to explore their autonomy, then that can really have adverse effects that ripple throughout the rest of their development, because that's one of the core, if you subscribe to Erikson's theory on psychosocial stages, like that's one of the core pieces in that. It's autonomy versus shame and doubt, which essentially is saying that if a child does not have the opportunity to explore their autonomy, then they will be stuck in this kind of stage of shame and doubt. And while they can advance past and regain this autonomy later in life, it's so much more difficult than if they're doing it when they're, you know, actually supposed to. And to be fair, that's between the ages of like 1 to 2 years. So there's a lot past that. And I could talk about this forever. But I don't think that they really, because of his situation, because of his degree of the curse, they never let him have any autonomy. They never let him explore. I'm sure he's stunted in a lot of places developmentally because of this parenting style that didn't let him make mistakes, learn for himself, and have an imagination. Imagination is a huge part of being a kid. And so if the height of his imagination is drawing fried eggs, then I don't know. Yeah.
It doesn't feel good.
It doesn't feel good.
No. And Kagura mentions that, and she says, compared to the cat, I wasn't unfortunate at all. Like, I had it good.
Yeah.
And do you think that many other Zodiac members look at Kyo in the same way?
Oh, yeah. I think that they all look down on him, like she admits to, which I love that she admitted that she actively looked down on him. But yes, to answer your question, I do think that a lot of them would look down on him and say, well, I have it bad, but at least I'm not that guy. You know, at least I'm not Kyo.
Yeah, like, sure, I turn into an animal sometimes, but, and they view themselves as monstrous in that way.
Yeah.
But they're like, at least I'm not actually, like, this monster that smells bad and is weird and grotesque. So, you know, I'm okay.
And so,
it hurts.
And so, even though she opened up about how her home life sucked, as many of the Zodiacs do, so it's not overly surprising. Her mom's great now. But I'm glad that she opened up about that too, because I was under the impression that her mom was just wonderful. But finding out that she had a bad home life, like most of the others, was nice. It was humanizing for her. She really came into her own this episode.
Yes.
The fact that she admits that she fell in love with him, or made herself fall in love with him, to make up for her running away from seeing his true form. Oof.
Big oof. And that one part when she said, "I dreamed of a pure version of myself that could accept your monstrous form," and she's holding on to that one, like one of the white beads from his bracelet.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and by the way, manga readers, I also thought that the bracelet breaking was an anime-only thing, but it does happen in the manga, so don't get grumpy. It did happen in the manga, too. It just wasn't as loud or noticeable, but it still did happen, so.
Do you know what that moment felt like? This sounds awful, but, like, do you know what the beads breaking made me instantly think of?
Hmm.
Any time when Batman, Bruce Wayne's parents die.
Yeah.
His mom's, like, pearl necklace always breaks and the beads go everywhere.
Oh.
That's what that felt like to me. I don't know. It has no thematic link, really. But visually, that's what I thought of. But I also like how her love, she admits, was selfish. It wasn't like she was trying to make up for being scared of him for his sake. She wanted to make herself feel good about it, or better about it. Like, if I fall in love with you, then I'm not the worst, because at least I came around, you know?
Mm-hmm. And it selfish wasn't... love doesn't wipe away pain. No.
And then he hits her with the, "I won't fall in love with you."
Which, oh my gosh, top 10 moments in the whole series for me. Like, it just hits me so hard. With the look on his face.
It hits, because I think this is the only time he's actively said it in a serious way. Because usually they're Tom and Jerrying it up, running around, like beating the snot out of each other in this, like, quote-unquote lover spat. But this is the first time he has just straightforward, outwardly said it to her. Yeah. And he says that she has nothing to apologize for.
Yeah, he doesn't care that she looked down on him. It's like he expected it. Because he does look down on himself, so why wouldn't other people look down on him, you know?
I'm sure he thinks that everyone does. Like, why would anyone like the cat in his mind?
Mm-hmm.
What reason could there possibly be for liking the cat?
And then he says, "I was happy you played with me and the music."
Oh, that's the thing that this show does so well. The music always hits perfectly for the moment. And that's the point when I actually started crying. I don't cry for things. This is, out of the last three episodes, I've now cried for two of them.
Yeah. Did both of them involve Kyo?
Yes.
Wow.
He's a very good boy.
He's a good boy. Protect him at all costs.
He's a very good boy. But, and then she gets so shook and sees, like, the shadows of them being kids run by and starts crying, and he actively comforts her and thanks her after she says that she loves him, and he comforts her until she stops crying, it seems like. And these two characters, I would say, are the two most emotionally intelligent characters in the show right now.
Yeah, I agree.
And they, if you told me that at the beginning of season one, when we first met the two of them, I would never believe you.
They did grow. They did grow. And I'm just so proud of Takaya, the author, because she even builds up side characters that you didn't think you'd ever like. I love her for that. That is why this is one of my favorite stories, because side characters you didn't even think you'd like, because, oh my gosh, cringy early 2000s, late 90s humor, girl always beats up the guy, ugh, hate it. And you come to like her and respect her because she's so honest. People usually take those kinds of issues that they have with themselves and how they've hurt others to their graves. And she admitted it.
Mm-hmm.
And she's still a teenager. Yeah. Like, geez.
she's still young. She's still impulsive. I don't know. Big, I like Kagura now. I actively like her. Before this episode, I would say she's one of my, like, least favorite in the show. I didn't like her. I didn't dislike her. I was very meh on her overall. Mm-hmm. But now I actively like her as a character and want to see more Kagura.
Aw, yay.
But
well, I do like Kagura, so there you go. That's my opinion on her. But I do have one last question for you about Kagura.
Yes.
Do you think
she has too many cats? Yes. I do.
She does have too many cats. Do you think that Kagura will come to dislike Tohru or become jealous? Or do you think that she's, like, come to terms that it won't work out and she should just let it be?
I don't think she will dislike her. Because the whole linchpin for her realizing all of this and her selfishness and all of this was seeing Tohru go after Kyo. And so if she truly wants what's best for Kyo now, I think that she, like Yuki, in terms of Kyo being the best for Tohru, I think she'll realize that they're good together and they're good for each other. So I don't think that she'll pull a 180 on this moment and just instantly start loathing Tohru. There might be like a little comedic rivalry, I guess, but I don't think she'll actively dislike Tohru.
Okay. I gotta ask the questions that the manga readers want to know, so
yeah.
Thank you.
So, but yeah.
Did you have anything else about this episode?
No. Not really. I think
okay,
that
hits
well,
our next episode is You Cried For Me, and Hattori is saying that. Any thoughts? Who's he talking to?
Who's he talking to? Maybe Tohru.
Okay.
My guess is either Tohru or Shigure. I think that they might have like a... If it's Shigure, it's like a bromance moment. If it's Tohru, it's how profoundly it touched him that she cried for him after just meeting him, even though he was trying to intimidate her away, and how that had a really big effect on him. I'm kind of leaning towards Tohru, but it could be Shigure, just because they bros.
Yeah. Well, I know you liked the Hattori-centric episode in season one.
Top five favorite episodes.
Oh, yeah. I have a feeling you're going to like this next one.
Oh, don't say that to me. We still have a week.
Oh, please. Try being me. And I'm looking forward to, like, the last 20 chapters.
Look. I'm sorry. But that would do it for this week's video, guys. And we want to hear your thoughts in the comment section down below. Whether you have questions for me if you're a manga reader, if you have comments to Allie about anything kind of spoilery, make sure to leave that in the comment section down below. And also, just give us your thoughts on the episode in general. We would love to hear them. And while you're down there, why not liking this video? Why not subscribing to our channel? And why not even ringing that notification bell so you never miss another upload? If you want to talk to us, make sure that you follow us on Twitter. The links to those are in the description down below. But with all that out of the way, we hope you have a fantastic rest of your day, a fantastic rest of your week, and why not even a fantastic rest of your month. And we will see you in the next video. Later.
See ya!